to the second morning session. This session is devoted to solid-state quantum systems and hybrid systems. And our first speaker is Almut Beige from the University of Leeds. And she's going to be talking about cavities, fibers, and fiber cavities. So hopefully that's going to be fine.
Thanks for
introducing
me. Whenever I go to a conference, my daughter complains that I'm going on holidays without her. And I have to admit, this has been a really nice conference, a nice holiday. So, my computer went on holiday, sorry. I will throw some atoms in at the end, but I'm the title is a little bit more what we would like to, what I would like to talk to you about. But what I'm really going to talk about is the same thing backwards. I will start with cavity fiber networks, but eventually we'll go down, simplify our system to cavities, and to talk about semi-transparent mirrors. Because it seems there are still a lot of open theoretical questions, and we have mainly been trying to deal with them in recent years. So what I will actually mainly talk about is how to quantize the electromagnetic field via a semi-transparent mirror, or if you put it in the language of linear optics, we're trying to derive Hamiltonian for beam splitters. So, but let's start with cavity fiber networks. So actually this paper came out 20 years ago, so this is the paper on quantum networks by Zirak, Zoller, Kimball, and Mobucci. So they effectively invented the quantum internet. Their idea was relatively simple. What they had is they proposed to have an optical cavity with an atom inside, and the idea is to drive the atom in a way that you create a photon that has a wave packet that is time reversible. So I have a very symmetric wave packet that is coming out. And then the idea was that if you do everything you did here on the other side of the cavity, but backwards in time, then you can argue that you have time reversal symmetry, and the photon that comes out here will with probability one end up in the atom there. So you have a nice way of communicating from one atom to another atom. But one of the problems here is, in the meantime, people have done a lot of progress towards implementing these kind of devices. So for example, Axel Kuhn in Oxford, he's now driving his cavity in a way that he creates photons that look like the Tower Bridge of London. But one of the problems, not really a problem, but one of the things that happens is the generation of these photons is relatively slow. So usually, for example, the photons in Wendt's lab, they're often more than 60 meters long. So they are very long, which means they are much longer than many of the fiber connections that people look at the moment. And all these nice arguments with time reversal symmetry only works if your photon really has come out of one of the cavities and then goes back in the other. Otherwise, you don't know if your photon is actually coming out. So to cut it short, what we've been interested in is looking at cavities that are cavity fiber networks that can be built, maybe easier, where we were interested in connecting cavities with fiber connections that might maybe only 1 meter long, so a lot shorter than the photons that you have created in one of those cavities. Our motivation was at the time, that was together with Elisa Kyo, Sefer, and Quick in Singapore, in around 2012, when we were thinking about it, we thought that maybe that's a way of building kind of photonic networks. You could put atoms in the cavities, and you would have one qubit, so you would have nodes with qubits. You could create interactions between those nodes and do something very similar to quantum simulators and optical lattices. But the big advantage would be that in these kind of setups, you could really connect everything with everything, and then you get can have complete connectivity between your qubits and not only next neighbor interactions. And I think that would, I don't know how it can be used, but I think that would make a huge speed up for quantum computing. So then we sat down and we wrote down a very naive model. So we assume that we have a very good cavity with a nice single mode here. We connect them with a fiber. If the fiber is a meter long, then the fiber is not a cavity itself. So we assume that we have a continuous mode system there. And then we have a resonant cavity also on the other side that also couples to the fiber. So what we did is we used a continuous mode description of left and right traveling photons for the fiber connection. And what we assumed is that whenever a photon, some excitation, leaks into the fiber, it will go back and forth very rapidly. Because when the fiber is only a meter long, it will go back and forth at the gigahertz rate, for example, which is quite high. And the idea was to then adiabatically eliminated the fiber photons because they have a much faster dynamics. So it's very similar to a system with a Raman transition. You have a slow time evolution here because you have a cavity that couples only weakly to the fiber. Your photon leaks out very slowly. You have a slow connection here. Everything in between happens very fast. So what we then do is we adiabatically eliminate the fiber cavity photons, the fiber photons, and what we were aiming at is to get the direct interaction between the cavity fields. So that's the calculation we did, and then we found the effective Hamiltonian with the direct exchange interaction between the cavities. And if you couple cavities, not only two cavities, but many cavities with a whole network, linear optics network, then in principle you can map the transfer matrix of that cavity network onto the Hamiltonian, and you get an interaction Hamiltonian where every cavity can interact with every other cavity in the network. So, and then we designed some examples. You could build three-dimensional arrays, and you could make networks with complete connectivity. But then the more we thought about it, we thought we don't really understand how this quantization works, how the modeling works. Are we really using the right Hamiltonian? And the more you look at it, the more questions rise up. So when the next PhD student arrived, we went back and had a look at how to model cavities, optical cavities, when you have finite decay rates. Not perfect cavities like how Rausch has them in his lab, but something that's more realistic. So we spent quite a bit of time on this. What do we know about optical cavities? So imagine that you have two mirrors. In the easiest case, you just have a glass plate with two surfaces. What we know from classical optics is that if you have light coming in from one side, and that light is resonant, the light will go back and forth many times, and then eventually you have constructive interference in the forward directions. So if you plot the transmission rate as a function of the wavelengths, you see at certain wavelengths you have 100% transmission rates. So for example, resonant light comes in and always goes out on the other side. But then when you have a look at how we model optical cavities in quantum optics, usually you have just a single mode in there. So if you have a laser that excites a single mode inside a cavity, there is nothing in your model that doesn't tell you that the photon has to come out on the other side. So because you have a model that doesn't contain the information of where your excitation initially came from, and it would be equally likely to go out on the left and on the right. So what we did is we had a look at the literature. So, and there is a lot of discussion on how to model two-sided optical cavities. I mean, for people from the linear optics community, for example, you avoid the problem completely. If you have a beam splitter and light comes from one side, you just use a transfer matrix and all the photons disappear on one side and reappear on the other and move away. And that's the easiest problem of solving it. But as a theoretician, that's not very satisfying, because as a theoretician, we want that every system has a Hamiltonian. We don't really want to say, okay, now we have a system where we put another formalism. There are other ways of fixing the problem One is the input-output formalism, which is a purely phenomenological approach. And most people who look at two-sided cavities, they now use the input-output formalism, which is very elegant and works very well. It's complicated when you want to model whole arrays of cavities and fibers, but it does the trick and is consistent with classical electrodynamics. The problem is it's not derived from basic canonical field quantization. So there are other models, for example, there's this nice universe model where people take a cavity and put a big box, the universe around it, and then they quantize the universe, the field in the universe, with boundary conditions. It all gets very complicated, and people have tried, but they haven't been able to show that this gives you the same result like the input-output formalism. To cut it short, we had a look at two-sided optical cavities. So just think of a glass plate. We send laser light in from one side. And what we did is we put the, instead of making a two-mode model, like all these previous models, they assume that essentially, like in the input-output formalism, you assume that you have a single mode cavity and you more or less fix the problem by adding more modes on the outside. What we did is we assumed a continuous mode model because I want photons in cavities to be the same what they also are in free space. So we put in an extra term in the Hamiltonian and said what the mirror does, it takes an incoming photon and turns it around and sends it back. I put that in the Hamiltonian, and if you want, you can really find coupling constants that fix. So now you have a laser that excites only one of the modes, and you can fix this constant in a way and choose it in a way that everything is consistent with classical electrodynamics. So we were very happy. All the special cases came out correctly. You got free space, you have perfect cavities, everything comes out fine. The only problem is when we then went back to cavity networks and put, for example, three mirrors, then we get non-Hermitian Hamiltonians. We even get non-Hermitian Hamiltonians when we have only a single surface, and we couldn't fix it because those Hamiltonians don't have real eigenvalues. And so we had to start again. I think the reason that there are many models that give the right, predict the right behavior is that bosons usually, photons are bosons, and when you have coherent states, doesn't matter how complicated you make your model, you always get the same predictions. You always get correlation functions that are equal to one, and then you can't distinguish those models. So we then sat down and we wrote a paper on how to quantize the field in free space. So that came out last year in the European Journal of Physics. What we did is we more or less said, we just had two speakers who showed us that you can detect single photons. So let's assume we know the field is made out of photons. Let's make that our assumption. We know what are the degrees of freedom that photons have. We know they have frequency, polarization, they have a directional propagation. So that all is enough to get a Hamiltonian. And once you have a Hamiltonian, you can say, okay, I want observables for the electric and the magnetic field. They behave like Maxwell's equations, the expectation values, and that immediately gives you then electric and magnetic field Hamiltonians. What is interesting about this is you never have to introduce a vector potential, you never have to talk about a certain gauge. That's what you get. If you accept that there are photons, we get everything gauge free in a more direct way. But this was the first step of towards having a closer look at what happens with the field near a beam splitter. So now the model we are looking at, the paper should be on the archive next week. It's essentially ready. So what Nick and some other people and I have been looking at is just a metallic thin surface, just a thin surface where we know what are the transmission and the reflection rates for light that's coming from both sides of the mirror. That's the only assumption we do. Absorption is taken into account, so we don't assume that transmission and reflection rates squared add up to one. So this is the system we look at. First question to ask is, what do we know how do we model the system classically? And classically, to describe a mirror, a perfect mirror, is very straightforward. What you do is you use an image method. So if you have a wave packet that travels towards the mirror, then what happens is it starts and wobbling around near the mirror, and then it turns, the light turns around and goes back. And to find a solution that is everywhere consistent with Maxwell's equations, or where you have always a zero electric field on the mirror surface, what you do is you look at the wave packet that goes to the right, then you introduce a mirror image. So you look at a wave packet that travels to, sorry, you have one that travels to the left, you have one that travels to the right, and you add up the electric fields. And if you add these two pictures up, and you make it zero whenever there's something on the left, you get exactly the behavior. Yeah? So this here, the time increases in this direction. So you have a wave packet that comes in, turns around, and goes back. Yeah? So you just have add a wave packet and the mirror image. Another way of looking at this is to say, when we have a mirror, light still propagates exactly as in free space. So because any wave packet that I have somewhere here and that's coming towards the mirror, it just propagates as in free space. Photons still have the frequency, the energy h per omega, when the frequency is omega. So the dynamics is exactly the same. The only thing that changed is the observables. So instead of detecting an electric field, how I do it in free space, what we have is that when we put an electric field detector next to a mirror, it sees contributions that are there, but it also sees the electric field behind the mirror. And this makes quantizing the field very easy. What we do is we write down the Hamiltonian that is exactly the same as when we quantize the field in free space. The only thing we change is our observable for the electric field. So we say we have a free field contribution at x, the detector position. Then we have a contribution from the other side of the mirror. Namely, when we also still see the wave packet when it has gone from x to minus x. And then we multiply with the theta function to make sure that we have only electric field in front of the mirror. So it's all very easy, and what we have here is annihilation and creation operators, which are exactly the same, have the same meaning as the meaning of, they describe photons as in free space. When we have a two-sided perfect mirror, what we need to do is we need to double the Hilbert space, because now we can have wave packets from one side, so that needs a complete description and one Hilbert space. Especially also when we want to be able to go backwards in time with our predictions. Then we need a Hilbert space for one side, and then we need another Hilbert space for the other side. And those wave packets never meet if the mirror is perfectly reflecting. So we just double, so our mirror observable is what we would have on one side and the contribution we have on the other side. Yeah. So that's fine, but now, what we can easily do now is we can have a mirror that is not perfectly transmitting. Because when we have a semi-transparent mirror, or how many people would call it a beam splitter, then we also double the Hilbert space, but now on every side of the mirror we have three contributions. We see the original wave packet, how it, when it comes in. If it has moves to the other side, and we see a reflected contribution, but we also see light that has come in from the other side and has been transmitted through the mirror. This took us a long time, there are normalization factors in the equations, but it's not surprising that our model depends not only on transmission and reflection rates, but also on normalization factors, because to see how the wave packet how the electric field, or what electric field you measure, also depends on not only what happens at the mirrors, but it also depends on what kind of space you have next to the mirror. Do you have free space, or do you have a dielectric? So you need to specify that somewhere. So what this does is, the electric field observable as a superposition of free space solutions. The Hamiltonian is the same as in free space. So everywhere, Maxwell's equations are consistent with how the dynamics that's predicted by these four expectation values. And these coefficients, the reflection and transmission rates, they make sure that we get the right long-term behavior. So the wave packet comes in, and we evolve it for a long time, we will have a transmitted, perfectly right, normalized wave packet going away, and another one that's turned around. So we don't have a way of finding what the normalization factors are. So then I make it a hybrid system, I throw an atom in there, and we calculate decay rates, and that will help us what the rates actually are. So what is different to previous models? So one of the things we do is we really quantize photons. So we really want to have photons, and we use the same notion of photons as we do in free space, even when there is a mirror, so we don't quantize modes. The only thing what we have to do with the mirror is we have to double the Hilbert space. And quantum mechanics doesn't tell us, or quantum physics doesn't tell us, what is the Hilbert space of a system. It only tells us there is a Hilbert space, and we have a Hamiltonian, and we have observables, and how they behave. So there is some degree of freedom we had. Yeah? So normally people reduce the Hilbert space when they introduce mirror surfaces. One of the things, because one thing you can do is we now have observables for the electric field, we also have the magnetic field observables, so you can calculate the amount of energy that you have in the electromagnetic field. And one of the things we find in our model is that now the energy of the system of an electromagnetic field and the mirror is not the same as the observable for the energy in the electromagnetic field. That kind of put us off for a little bit, but it makes complete sense. What we find is that the energy, the expectation value of the field are always smaller than the energy expectation values of the total system. And for example, when you describe a wave packet that travels towards a perfect mirror, and what we find is that always exactly half of the energy is in the electromagnetic field, and the other half belongs to the mirror image. So you have some energy that belongs to the mirror surface. And I think that's the main difference to previous model. What previous models did is you do a kind of mode expansion, and you only look at symmetric modes with no E field on the mirror surface. And so you look at the subset of modes, you reduce the Hilbert space, and you only look at the modes where the system energy and the electric field energy is exactly the same. But in general, we don't have a perfect mirror with waves coming from both sides. They usually come from only one side. And then you have to take the energy of the mirror image into account. Another tricky bit that took us a bit of time is when this is all in one dimension, when you go to three dimension, you have to be really careful because mirrors have a very strange symmetry. If you stand in front of a mirror and you move forwards, your image also moves forwards. But when you move sideways, then the image also moves sideways. But so it's a bit of a complicated symmetry. Okay, so we have what we have now is we have a Hamiltonian for the system, a Hamiltonian for the field, and we have electric and magnetic field observables. What I still need is the normalization factors. So we put an atom in front of the semi-transparent mirror, and we calculate the decay rates, and we get a decay rate, which is looks a bit complicated here. But what we can do now is we can say, if I have a mirror, and my atom is far away from the mirror, then I want it to decay exactly as in free space. And this condition then fixes our decay rates, our normalization factors that were free. So it looks complicated, and normally in physics things are only right when they are simple. But what you have to keep in mind in this case is that all the expressions we derive, they apply to anything. They apply to free space. So if you put your reflection rates equal to zero and transmission rates equal to one, you get exactly the free space behavior back. Or if you make a perfectly absorbing mirror, then your RA goes to zero, then the atom decays as if there is no mirror. So all these special cases, or the perfect mirror where you have a perfect reflection, all of this is built into this one system. Yeah? Or you could have a dielectric on one side of the mirror and something else on the other side, and this model still holds. So you can still use this model. Okay. So then here's some pictures. So we looked at, but they are more or less the standard ones, what you expect. If your atom is far away from the surface, it decays as in free space. When you come closer, you have interference effects. And essentially you have a way of interpreting this effect as what you would expect also. If you have a mirror here and you have an atom with a dipole moment on this side, then you have essentially an interaction that is the interaction between an atom with this dipole moment and an atom with this dipole moment. And it's exactly what comes out for having two dipole interacting atoms in free space. And so it's what is equivalent to an atom in front of the mirror classically is also equivalent to an atom in front of the mirror in the quantum model. So maybe I'm stopping a bit early. So what I have done is I more or less told you about our current work on quantizing the electromagnetic field near a semi-transparent mirror. And the paper should be on the archive on Monday. That's what we're hoping for. It's all ready. So what we could do next is we could now go from semi-transparent mirrors, go back to have a closer look at optical cavities and see how we best model two-sided optical cavities. What we might find is just the input-output formalism, but at least then we have it is derived from basic principles, which would already be nice. If you find something else, then it's also hopefully nice and not wrong. And then we could have another go at cavity-fibre networks. In the meantime, there have been lots of developments, so we might look at other simpler problems first. For example, Axel Kuhn's group in Oxford is doing experiments now where they send photons on the beam splitters. But as I said earlier, these photons are now really, really long. They are more than 60 meters long. So one of the games that he can play is when he sends in two photons onto a beam splitter, one of the things he can do is by the time he detects one of his detectors clicks, he has enough time to change the phase of the photon because he hasn't finished creating the photons yet. So he can add a phase factor, and then what he seems to do is he creates magic photons. So he creates photons that don't behave like bosons anymore. They start behaving like photons, as like fermions, and they click on the detectors in the same way as fermions would do. And I think that's a really exciting perspective for quantum computing because, as we have heard in talks, for example, on Wednesday, if we had fermions, then we might be able to do a lot more. Yeah. But as a theoretician, we try to come up with fancy words, and at the moment I don't understand yet how that exactly works. But at least we have the model now to describe photons that are not exactly identical. Yeah, so we know how identical photons behave on the beam splitter, but in principle we can now make also predictions of how photons behave when there is a difference between the two, or if we do some dynamical changes to the photons that hit the beam splitter. And then hopefully one day we also look at cavity fiber networks again, or someone else looks at it, and it's hopefully a useful model. That was it, thanks.
Very much. Time for questions. Down there? Oh. There's a microphone.
Thanks, Almut. Traditionally, dealing with absorbing dielectrics is difficult because you need to max degrees of freedom in order to preserve commutators. Whereas here, you seem to have changed the electric field operating rather than changing the modal structure. To what extent could you use that in normal absorbing dielectrics?
At the moment, I have to be careful. The mirror that we describe, we say we have transmission and reflection rates. And the reason that we think we can take absorption into account is because our Hamiltonian for the electric field and the system Hamiltonian are not the same. Yeah? So when we have a wave packet coming in, the wave packet propagates as in free space. But the expectation value of the energy in the electric field doesn't need to be preserved because that's not our system Hamiltonian. So that can go down in time. The only assumption what we make is that when a wave packet comes in and meets the mirror, there's only a transmission rate. Yeah, so the shape of the wave packet doesn't get changed by the mirror. That's the only assumption that goes in. But in principle, energy can flow from the field onto the mirror. Then, you can ask what exactly happens on the mirror surface and what does the medium do? And then I think I can't answer it. That part is completely phenomenological here. But having a difference between system and mirror Hamiltonian allows us to
have absorption taken into account. So your description suitable for both metallic mirror and the dielectric mirrors.
We have enough free parameters in our equations. So if you have a single mirror surface, we have transmission and reflection rate for it. If then what you have on one side of the mirror is a dielectric, then you can choose the normalization constants in a different way because your free space decay rate on one side of the mirror is different from the free space decay on the other side. So you see another more density if you want. So that's all, it should all be, what definitely comes out correctly is if you make the transition, or this model contains everything, it contains the free space as well as having a lightly reflecting mirror. So that, yeah.
Any other question? I actually have a quick question. So, how easy would it be to adapt this formalism to rack type mirrors that are not just sharp transitions?
Yeah, that was one of the motivations for looking into it because experimentalists don't seem to know anymore how long their cavity is because the mirrors are made out of stacks. We haven't looked into that yet. Yeah, but that's definitely something. There are a few semi-classical models in the literature where they argue with more densities, but this should work too. Yeah. We would need an extra Hilbert space for every bit in between, but yeah.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, let's take Almut then.